Hello, I'm John Gaver, author of The Rich Don't Pay Tax or Do They? And I'm sitting here today with Jameson Ellis, who's running for Congress for Texas District 2. He, like me, has been moved over from Texas 8 to Texas 2. And he's here today to sign the FAIRtax candidate pledge. But before we get to that, I'd like to ask, why did you get into the race in the first place? What is your impetus for getting in?
Yeah, well, first of all, I just want to thank you for reaching out and for giving me the opportunity to learn more about the FAIRtax pledge. And as somebody that believes in Jeffersonian tax principles and would like to see them restored, I'm also a realist. So I also understand that we have to look at where we're at today and how can we optimize where we're at to bring taxes down and make sure that the tax system that we have benefits everybody at every single level. So thank you for the opportunity. So my story actually starts back May 25th of 2020. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's a very significant date for two reasons. One, it's my birthday. Okay. Second reason, though, is because that's the day that the George Floyd incident happened. And over the next 60 days, we saw over 500 and 600 declared riots.
Yeah.
And over 2,000 law enforcement officers that were injured in the line of duty. And I looked at our government leaders in D.C. Actually, I looked at government leaders all over the country, and most of them did absolutely nothing. They sat on their butts while others actually encouraged and incited even more violence.
So, right.
So this was about July. We were in the middle of what we call a Blue Crew Live, and we were live on Facebook in front of hundreds of thousands of people. And I feel like not to freak anybody out, but I am a Christian, so I feel like I got a word from the Lord. And he said, you know, Jameson, what's going on with law enforcement right now is a symptom of a much deeper issue. And so in that moment, I felt like I needed to do more. I had to do more. And so I was like, do I run for office? What do I do? I didn't even talk to my wife about it. I'm like, I feel like I need to do something, you know? But is it Congress? Is it local? Like, what do I do? 2 weeks later, I get a message, a random message on Facebook from a gal out of Wichita Falls that says, you know, hey, I didn't want to share something with you. Now, I didn't know this lady.
Mm-hmm.
So this is probably going to freak some of you out. I didn't know this lady, but she actually reached out to me on Messenger and says, hey, can I share something with you? And I was like, sure. She said, well, I had a dream about you. I'm like, uh-oh.
Yeah.
Anyways, so basically she said, you've been, I had a dream about you and I saw you in Congress. And that's been on your heart, hasn't it? And you haven't even told anybody. So she read my mail to me and I'm like, okay, that was confirmation. Well, I started doing some research, mm-hmm. right? So I realized that we have 435 voting members of the House.
Mm-hmm.
Only 40, or maybe just less than 40, actually have true conservative voting records. And then I looked at Texas. So people say, oh, keep Texas red. Texas ain't red, it's purple.
Yeah.
Until just a couple of months ago, we've had 36 districts here in Texas. Can any of you guess how many of those districts actually have true conservative representation?
Yeah.
13. And that's being nice. And so, you know, everybody's been talking about what happened with the election. Everybody's been talking about, you know, where we're at as a nation and why we're here. And people always want to blame Democrats. They want to blame Democrats. Well, I can tell you this. We're where we're at as a nation, not because of Democrats. And I know that a lot of people don't want to hear that. We're where we are as a nation right now because of Republicans. And I'm going to prove it to you. I fully expect Democrats to act and vote like Democrats. That's never going to change. But I have an issue when you have Republicans like Dan Crenshaw that act and vote like Democrats. But how we got here in District 2 is another story. So I started, like you said, John, we started off in District 8. And there was some gerrymandering that went on. And all of a sudden, after the redistricting maps were released, turns out the part of Conroe in which I live is District 2. And to be a man of principle, you know, I've always said from the very beginning that I believe that a congressman needs to represent the district that they actually live in.
Yes.
And so once I was redistricted, I made the switch from District 8 to District 2. But I don't like to say that I switched districts. I like to say that the district switched me.
Yes.
And so here we are. We're here today. We had a lot of momentum in District 8. And our momentum has just skyrocketed once we made the switch in District 2 because, you know, we had a lot of voters here in 2, especially East Montgomery County. And so now that we're all in the same district, it's time to fire D.C. from D.C. So
there you go. Well, why? Tell me just some of the things you like about the FAIRtax. You're about to sign the FAIRtax candidate pledge. Tell me what it is about the FAIRtax that you like most.
Well, so first of all, I'm not a believer in direct taxation. I don't like this progressive income tax. And I believe that we're immorally taxed. and I believe we're overtaxed. And so, you know, at first I was like, okay, our founding fathers, what they initially envisioned was more of a flat tax, right? And then whenever you and I got on the phone and we started talking through the FAIRtax, it was a little bit of a cognitive dissonance type of moment where I'm like, is there really a better plan than just a straight FAIRtax? I'm sorry, just a straight flat tax. So anyway, so after I started digging and doing some more research, because it took me a while to finally commit to meeting with you, because I wanted to make sure that I did my research. I wanted to make sure if I'm going to put my name on something, it needs to be, it's going to be 110%, because I don't ever do anything half-cocked.
Yeah, we've been talking for a couple of months now.
Yeah. And so one of the things that I absolutely love is, as a small business owner, okay, the federal government forces me to be a tax collector against my will, because they know that if they go directly to the citizen to collect taxes, the citizen's probably going to vote differently. So instead, what do? They come to us, the small business owners. FAIRtax completely gets rid of that, because it does away with an income tax. Instead, it is a sales tax. And I love the fact that it does away with the IRS. I love the fact that no matter what, the max percentage of taxes is 23%. And the only person that's ever going to pay 23%, which, what is the current tax rate? What is the current going tax rate with the current plan?
The top tax rate is 37%.
37%.
Yes.
So this goes 10% down to
10% is the lowest, 37%.
So this brings it down to 23%. But the only person that's ever going to pay 23% is an illegal alien, which I believe they need to be deported anyway. We're having an invasion of our southern border, and so we could talk about that another time. But
that might even help them decide to self-deport.
Yeah. But everybody else, they get that prebate, because you're only taxed up after the poverty level. So if you're a single mom, you're only making 10, 12 grand a year, and you're a single mom, you have two kids, you're not going to pay any taxes. And you get to keep 100% of your paycheck. Something else I like and I want to bring up is that if you're a farmer or you're somebody that doesn't need to go purchase a whole lot, right? If you've got your own seeds and everything else, if you've got, you know, you've got everything that you need, you're only ever going to pay, like if you go get gas, you'll pay your taxes at the gas pump, right? If you need to go buy seed, you'll pay your taxes for that. But if you grow your own food, you get to keep 100% of the money that you earn. And to me, that's fair.
Yes.
That's fair.
All right. Well, that's good to know. You're one of the best spoken persons on the FAIRtax that I've talked with among all the various people. A lot of people understand it, but you seem to really have it in your head. So that's good to hear. Well, let's go ahead and get on with signing it here. You print your name, and you can scratch through the area where it says for Senate. Let's see here. Scratch through from Senate through or. Just scratch that line right through there. Right. And now you're going to put in your name for the state of Texas, District 2.
I can type a million words a minute, but my handwriting is horrible.
Yeah, right. Mine too. Okay, and then I think we print and sign here. Let's see. That's sign and date, and that's print. So print it there, and then sign and date the next line up.
And what is today? Today is the 6th?
Yeah. Should be. It was the 6th the last time I checked, yeah. And I will witness that in a few moments.
Okay.
Okay. Well, thank you, Jameson, for signing the FAIRtax pledge and stepping up. I know when you're running against an incumbent, you need to stand out. And so far, I don't think we're going to see, from what I can tell, we're not going to see the incumbent signing his pledge. I'm still working on him, but I don't think we're going to see that. So that makes you stand out. One of two people in the district.
One last thing I want to say, because I think this is important, especially when we're talking about somebody like Dan Crenshaw. This also eliminates all of the special interest bureaucratic BS. And that's something else that I really like. It disempowers the bureaucrats. It disempowers the crony capitalism. And I love it. And one last thing I want to make sure, because right now we have millions of taxpayers. Okay. That's why the IRS has a lot of work on their hands. Because all of the taxes are collected at a state level, that brings it down to how many was, because you have the states and territories.
I think you've got like four territories that actually have.
So about 54. Business. So that brings it down to 54.
Six territories, but only four of them actually have any kind of business relationships or anything going on.
So 54 entities that are now paying the federal government, because it's all handled by the state, which means there's more accountability on the federal government, because the states are supposed to be more powerful than the federal government. The federal government's only role is two things. It's to protect your God-given liberties and to secure our borders from outside invasion. That's it. And so this empowers the states, and I love that.
Yeah. Well, that's great. Well, anyway, thank you for signing the FAIRtax Pledge, and we'll get on. This will be aired on FAIRtax Power Radio. I can't tell you exactly when. It'll be a few weeks, probably. My name's John Gaver, author of The Rich Don't Pay Tax, here in support of the FAIRtax with congressional candidate Jameson Ellis for Texas District 2. Thank you.
Let's go, Brandon.